Sunrise Semester. WCBS TV, in cooperation with New York University, presents English C81.1, the literature of modern Ireland, with Professor David H. Greene. This morning, Professor Greene concludes his lectures on Ulysses.
You know, one of the happiest moments in Homer's Odyssey is the account of how Odysseus is reunited with his faithful son Telemachus in the hut of Eumaeus, the swineherd. And Homer tells us the story of how the father and son go up to their home in Ithaca and find a rather difficult domestic problem involving suitors who are besieging the faithful Penelope. And they dispose of all of the suitors, and the Homeric poem ends in a moment of happiness and glory and achievement for Odysseus and his family. Now, if Ulysses by James Joyce has one meaning, it is that in the modern world of today, the heroic ideal cannot possibly exist. Or if it exists, it has to exist in a different form from that which the classic poets of antiquity pictured it as. The heroic ideal is gone because the heroic age has gone. And if you translate the terms of the Homeric poem into modern terms, you don't get the same kind of idyllic characters and idyllic life. What we have is a 38-year-old Dublin solicitor, advertising solicitor, whose wife is not faithful to him, who has no son. And the modern world that he lives in will not allow him to face the kind of solution that the Homeric hero faces. Now, in the Ithaca episode in Ulysses, which is the next to the last episode of the entire book, the action of the novel takes place at 2 o'clock in the morning, and the episode runs from page 650 to 722. Now, what has happened in this episode is that Leopold Bloom and Stephen Dedalus, spiritual father and spiritual son, have had a moment of happiness, shall we say, a moment of sobriety, a moment of union or reunion. Bloom, who has to go back to the home where his wife has been unfaithful to him that very afternoon, realizes that he has to go back and face tomorrow and face the life that one must face. And he invites Stephen to go back with him, ostensibly to have a cup of cocoa in the kitchen. But as it turns out later, he also offers him a bed for the night. It's interesting, of course, that it's Joyce's purpose not to have Stephen accept the invitation. For Joyce, there is to be no happy solution to life's dilemma. This moment of union between spiritual father and spiritual son is to end. Fortunately, the novel doesn't end there, and you can't say that Ulysses, with all its tragedy, ends in a note of a negative note completely. At least that's my position. Of course, the last word in the novel is yes, I know, in Penelope, but it's an ironic yes, because it's the yes that Molly Bloom utters to her, in her memory, to her first lover, not to her husband. But it is a note of yes, no matter how you look at it. This is a kind of grim and ironic kind of affirmation, but it's affirmation nevertheless. And for me, the great message of Ulysses is that if life is no longer heroic, it's livable, and that people can live it and can live it with dignity. And Bloom, with all his pathetic failings, has the capacity for suffering that the heroic man on our terms has to have. And we know that Bloom will rise in the morning and face the future with whatever equipment he has, and that's all that one can expect in the modern world. It's a grim message that the novel gives us, but it's worked out with dignity and with truth. Now, in the Ithaca episode, Bloom and Stephen find themselves in front of number 7 Eccles Street, the house that Bloom has left that morning to go off on his day's activities. And Joyce, I think, did one of the most perverse things you can imagine. Remember, I told you previously that the scene in the lying-in hospital called The Oxen of the Sun is pretty much of a loss of effort for me. I think at times that this episode comes very, very close to being a loss of effort. For some perverse reason, Joyce chose to write it in the form of a catechism. In other words, the whole episode is formulated in terms of questions and answers. The style is, of course, an artificial style. It's the style of parody. And the whole episode, mind you, which one would normally expect to be the great moment in the novel, the moment that this novelist has been building toward for 650 pages, and Joyce rather perversely writes the whole thing in the stilted language of the catechism. Not only that, but he seems to be interested in the strangest things. The episode opens with a series of questions involving statistics about the Dublin water system, the geography of the city. The statistical approach is emphasized over and over again. One brilliant Joycean critic, Mr. Harry Levin, says that he thinks that this is what he would call the dead end of naturalism. That Joyce was answering the naturalists who subscribe to the theory that human character is the product of sociological, economic, and biological forces, and that if you would understand human character and human temperament, merely try to understand those forces which produce them. Says Mr. Levin, Joyce is showing them that this is what would happen if you extend that premise to its logical conclusion, that what you would get is human tragedy explained in terms of statistics, in terms of facts and figures about the Dublin water system and about the geography of Dublin. Well, I wouldn't like to think that Joyce dedicated a whole episode in this very important book to accomplishing a rather ridiculous objective like that, and yet I must admit that this is more or less what it accomplishes. Now, the episode is not difficult to read, and therefore you should read it carefully. And, of course, another thing that I think one can say that Joyce accomplishes here is that all the way through the book, what he has been intent upon doing is in debunking the modern Odysseus. He has been taking Bloom apart. Some people think he takes him apart so thoroughly that there's nothing left of Bloom at the end. Well, I don't think that's true. I think there's a good deal of Bloom left. But Bloom is systematically stripped of every facet of his character. This is Mr. Everyman, and the tawdriness of his life, and the pathos, the pathetic tragedy of his life, is suddenly reduced to the empty jars on the shelf of his kitchen cupboard, to the rather pathetic items that he has hidden locked up in the drawer of his bureau, to the contents of his pocket, all of those strange and odd objects that a man collects in his pocket, the annotations in his diary, the petty expenses that he has expended during the day. All of human character, you see, is reduced to the physical elements that compose the physical human being, until you wonder whether Joyce believed that there was anything sacred at all about the human personality. Certainly, when he gets through, there doesn't seem to be a great deal left of Bloom. And the passage goes on. Now, the discussion between Bloom and Stephen, always in this form of catechism, is very, very interesting because Joyce contrasts the two, spiritual father and spiritual son. He tells us a lot about the characters that we hadn't known before. On page 666, he tells us, for instance, had Bloom and Stephen been baptized, and where and by whom, cleric or layman? Now, I'm reading this to you because this bothers a lot of my students. Bloom, three times, by the Reverend Mr. Gilmer Johnston, M.A., alone in the Protestant Church of St. Nicholas Without, Coombe, by James O'Connor, Philip Gilligan, and James Fitzpatrick, together, under a pump in the village of Swords, and by the Reverend Charles Malone, C.C., in the Church of the Three Patrons, Rathgar. What this means, of course, is that Bloom, who is a Jew, only not a good Jew, and this thought haunts him all the way through the book. This man is stripped, you see, even of his Jewishness. He isn't even a good Jew. If he had had that, he would have had something to give him identity. But he has been baptized into the Protestant Church. He has been baptized into the Roman Catholic Church. And one night he was baptized by three drunken friends under a pump in the town of the village of Swords. There's a lot of humor, you see, in the episode. Joyce is summing up all the time, too, about his characters. And this is why you can't ignore this episode. What two temperaments, he says on page 667, did they individually represent? Answer, the scientific and the artistic. We've seen all the way through the book, haven't we, how Joyce has worked this out. Bloom is always interested in the scientific aspect of things, and Stephen, of course, who is the artist. A lot of Bloom's family life comes out, his feeling about Molly. He loves Molly, even though she's unfaithful to him. And he's annoyed at a lot of imperfections in her character. On page 670, she had interrogated constantly at varying intervals as to the correct method of writing the capital initial of the name of a city in Canada, Quebec. She couldn't tell the difference between Q and O. In calculating the addenda of bills, she frequently had recourse to digital aid. She had to count on her fingers. And her efforts to improve her mind were pathetic and futile. And Bloom, the fastidious man, doesn't think very much of this. He and Stephen discuss a number of things. Memories of their childhood come out. On page 679, he finally says to Stephen, "Will you stay the night?" And Stephen says, "No." It's interesting that both Stephen and Bloom feel dispossessed. Bloom by the unfaithfulness of his wife and the fact that his home is not his castle. Stephen by the fact that his arrogant friend Buck Mulligan has the key to his Martello Tower, and Stephen has been ditched and has sworn that he will not go back to the tower for the night. Interestingly enough, when they get to 7 Eccles Street at the beginning of the episode, Bloom, it turns out, has forgotten his key. Both of these men, you see, are keyless citizens, and Bloom has to go through the window, climb through a window to get into his house. All of these little things add, of course, to the ironic situation in which the two important characters are. And then Joyce, I think this is the most perverse moment in the book. When Dedalus decides to go, and the two of them walk to the front door of the house and out into the backyard or out of the front yard, this is the moment, this is the kiss-off, this is the moment of farewell. And how does Joyce write it? Also in the form of question and answer. Alone, what did Bloom hear? The double reverberation of retreating feet on the heaven-born earth. The double vibration of a Jew's harp in the resonant lane. Alone, what did Bloom feel? The cold of interstellar space. Thousands of degrees below freezing point, or the absolute zero of Fahrenheit. Well, this is a great moment of tragedy, and we describe it in terms of a reading off a thermometer. On page 692, when Stephen has left and Bloom is alone in his house, faced with his destiny, his future, Joyce is not through with him. The cruelty with which Joyce keeps at him, of course, strikes us all the time. On page 693, we have a careful catalog of all the books in Bloom's library, Mr. Everyman's library. And it's a strange collection of books. As a matter of fact, Joyce, who is a very academic writer, is very fond of giving us a bibliography. And some of the books in Leopold Bloom's library are the books that gave Joyce the information to write Ulysses, like the first one, Tom's Dublin Post Office Directory, issue of 1886. And there are other things, thoughts from Spinoza, which make us realize why Bloom mentioned Spinoza's name to the citizen in Barney Kiernan's pub, and various other books, the titles of which we've seen all the way through. Most ironic of all is the book called Physical Strength and How to Obtain It by Eugene Sandow. Odysseus subscribing to lessons to build his muscles up. Well, Bloom has to go to bed, and as he goes up to bed, Molly, of course, is in bed long ahead of him and sound asleep. Bloom, at the bottom of page 708, as he's going to bed, has feelings, and Joyce says, "Why did Bloom experience a sentiment of remorse?" Because in immature impatience, he had treated with disrespect certain beliefs and practices. As the prohibition of the use of flesh meat and milk at one meal. And then he goes on, of course, expressing his feelings of guilt about the religion of his fathers. He finally gets up into bed, and as he's climbing into bed, he remembers all of the men that he knows have slept with his wife. He has assembled a list of 25 of them in all, and he has arranged them in his mind in chronological order. Now, the interesting thing about that list, which you'll find on page 716, is that you must look at it very, very carefully and very critically, because every bit of factual information we've had from Bloom up till now has been inaccurate. And it's the strangest list. Mr. Ellman says in an article which he wrote about Joyce, "When we look at the list, it contains some extraordinary names. There are two priests, a Lord Mayor, an alderman, a gynecologist, a bootblack, a professor. There'd have to be a professor there. In the book, it is clear that she has confessed to the priests, consulted with the gynecologist, and coquetted with the rest. Well, that just reminds you that you have to be very careful taking any information from Bloom. He gets into bed, he awakens his wife, and she says to him, "Where have you been all day?" And he gives her a censored account of his activities. He neglects to mention, as Joyce says, clandestine correspondence between Martha Clifford and Henry Flower, the public altercation at or in the vicinity of the licensed premises of Barnard Kiernan, and it goes on. The episode concludes with Bloom going to sleep. Incidentally, he sleeps with his head to the foot of the bed, and Molly with her head to the head of the bed. And as Bloom goes to sleep, he rolls up in a ball, off the stern, shall we say, and Joyce writes, "Womb weary, he rests, he has traveled with Sinbad the sailor and Tinbad the tailor and Jinbad the jailer and Winbad the whaler," and the list goes on, and I think what Joyce is telling us is that symbolically at least, Bloom returns to the womb. He assumes almost a fetal shape as he lies at the foot of the bed. And Molly, of course, is the eternal mother, symbolically in the novel. And Bloom sort of passes off into what Yeats called in a memorable phrase, the artifice of eternity. He becomes what he has been from the very beginning anyway, a symbol of every man, Sinbad the sailor and Tinbad the tailor. And we realize that what Joyce has been doing in his own way is telling us not just the story of a 38-year-old advertising man in the city of Dublin in the year 1904, but what he has been trying to do is tell us something about the history of every man who ever lived, the race itself. Because the end of the story is that in Finnegan's wake, he went even farther than that, as we all know. Now, what's left of Ulysses? Well, the best is left. The famous last episode called Penelope, which runs from page 723 to 768. It's 45 pages long. And this was the passage in Ulysses, of course, which attracted the most sensational attention when the novel was first published. This is the passage which really stands outside the novel, because Leopold Bloom does not appear in it, nor does Stephen Dedalus. Molly Bloom, his wife, whom we have had fragmentary glimpses of earlier in the novel, we have seen only in bed. In this particular episode, and that's a good place for Molly to be, realizing, as we do, what her activity is. In this particular episode, the episode opens with Molly lying in bed, her husband asleep, she's been awakened, and she thinks about her life and about reality as she knows it. Later on in the episode, she gets up and goes to the bathroom, and her thoughts continue, and then finally, at the end of the episode, she goes back to bed, and we are left, of course, after 722 pages of this wonderful book, with 45 pages devoted to a character whom we have heard of, but seen only indistinctly in the earlier pages of the book. You might call it a very fancy word. You might say that it's a coda. That's a term from the language of music. And it means some sort of a musical appendix which stands outside the structure of the novel as a whole, but comments on it. One wouldn't want Ulysses without it, and yet at the same time, it's not really a vital part of the structure of the novel. The novel ends on page 722 with Bloom going to sleep. Now, what else should I point out to you? Well, something that you can see quite clearly and that you knew long before you read Ulysses, probably, that these 45 pages are printed without the aid of punctuation. It's one long and remarkable interior monologue. And of course, since the interior monologue is the direct quotation of the mind, what Joyce is doing is taking us into the mind of this remarkable woman. Now, I'm going to read you some portions of it because you have to get, I think, a feeling for the texture of the monologue, especially this particular monologue, to understand how it goes. For instance, on page 73, when the monologue opens, Molly is saying subconsciously to herself, "Yes, because he never did a thing like that before, as asked to get his breakfast in bed with a couple of eggs since the City Arms Hotel, when he used to be pretending to be laid up with a sick voice. doing his highness to make himself interesting to that old faggot, Mrs. Reardon, that he thought he had a great leg of. And she never left us a farthing. All for masses, for herself and her soul. Greatest miser ever was. Actually afraid to lay out fourpence for her methylated spirit. Telling me all her ailments. She had too much old chat in her about politics and earthquakes and the end of the world. Let us have a bit of fun first. God help the world if all the women were her sort. Down on bathing suits and low necks, of course, nobody wanted her to wear. I suppose she was pious because no man would look at her twice. I hope I'll never be like her. I wonder she didn't want us to cover our faces. But she was a well-educated woman, certainly, and her gabby talk about Mr. Reardon here and Mr. Reardon there. I suppose he was glad to get shot of her and her dog smelling my fur and always edging to get up under my petticoats, especially. Now, you have to read the monologue rapidly, of course, because this is the speed with which it passes through the mind of the human character. You not only have to read it rapidly, but you have to assume, of course, that these thoughts are not being consciously formulated. This is the nature of the interior monologue. Another thing you have to assume, too, is that since you have been taken on a guided tour into the recesses of the human mind, that the person whose thoughts are being given to you doesn't feel it necessary to prepare you by transitions, so that Molly's thoughts, when they pass from one person to another, pass without any warning. At the beginning of this passage, she's thinking of a Mrs. Reardon, who is a hypocrite, Molly says. She's down on low necks, no low neck dresses and bathing suits, because she herself isn't attractive enough to wear one. And then notice that the Molly's thoughts immediately veer to a discussion, not of Mrs. Reardon, but of Leopold Bloom. Now, all the way through the interior monologue, Molly tells us about herself and her life. She tells us about her affair that afternoon with Blazes Boylan. She tells us a good deal about her attitude toward Bloom. One can't be too sympathetic about this. We learn, for instance, on page 734 that Boylan lost 20 pounds on the race that day, the Gold Cup race, and one can cheer at least for that happening in the novel. She tells us about a lot of the men whose names appear on the list that Bloom has concocted of his wife's lovers. And then at the very end of the episode, she demonstrates the fact that she is a poet. And that she's one of the finest poets, I think, in literature. If you look at the last remarkable page and a half of the monologue, which runs from page 766 to the very end, I think you'll see Joyce at his best. And I think possibly you will do some rethinking about Molly. I assume that most of you have a feeling that Molly's a slut, that she's not only immoral or amoral, but she's brutal to her husband, Bloom. Well, read this carefully and see if you won't change your mind about it. As the monologue begins, she's thinking about arguments she's had with her husband about religion, about making love with him on Hoth Head, the very incident that Bloom himself remembered in Davy Byrne's public house. Then the thoughts pass rapidly to the memories of her childhood in Gibraltar and of her first lover, a Lieutenant Mulvey in the English Army. And notice the occurrence of the word yes, and the recurrence of that word and how it becomes a refrain in the monologue. I love flowers. I'd love to have the whole place swimming in roses. God of heaven, there's nothing like nature. The wild mountains, then the sea and the waves rushing, then the beautiful country with fields of oats and wheat and all kinds of things and all the fine cattle going about that would do your heart good to see. Rivers and lakes and flowers, all sorts of shapes and smells and colors springing up even out of the ditches. Primroses and violets, nature it is. As for them saying there's no God, I wouldn't give a snap of my two fingers for all their learning. Why don't they go and create something, I often asked him. Atheists, or whatever they call themselves, go and wash the cobbles off themselves first. Then they go howling for the priest and they dying. And why? Why? Because they're afraid of hell on account of their bad conscience. Ah, yes, I know them well. Who was the first person in the universe before there was anybody that made it all? Who are? That they don't know, neither do I. So there you are. They might as well try to stop the sun from rising tomorrow. The sun shines for you, he said the day we were lying among the rhododendrons on Hoth Head in the gray tweed suit and his straw hat. The day I got him to propose to me, yes, first I gave him the bit of seed cake out of my mouth and it was like leap year. Like now, yes, 16 years ago, my God, after that long kiss, I near lost my breath. Yes, he said I was the flower of the mountain. Yes, so we are flowers all. A woman's body, yes, that was one true thing he said in his life. And the sun shines for you today. Yes, that was why I liked him. Because I saw he understood or felt what a woman is. And I knew I could always get round him, and I gave him all the pleasure I could, leading him on till he asked me to say yes. And I wouldn't answer first, only looked out over the sea and the sky. I was thinking of so many things he didn't know of. Mulvey and Mr. Stanhope and Hester and Father, and old Captain Groves and the sailors playing All Birds Fly, and I say stoop and washing up dishes, they called it on the pier. And the sentry in front of the governor's house with a thing round his white helmet, poor devil, half roasted, and the Spanish girls laughing in their shawls and their tall combs, and the auctions in the morning, the Greeks and the Jews and the Arabs, and the devil knows who else from all the ends of Europe, and Duke Street and the fowl market all clucking outside Lobby Sharon's, and the poor donkey slipping half asleep, and the vague fellas in the cloaks asleep in the shade on the steps, and the big wheels of the carts of the bulls, and the old castle, thousands of years old, yes, and those handsome Moors all in white and turbans like kings, asking you to sit down in their little bit of a shop, and Rhonda with the old windows of the Posada's glancing eyes, a lattice hid, for her lover to kiss, the iron and the wine shops half open at night, and the castanets and the night we missed the boat at Algeciras, the watchman going about serene with his lamp, and oh, that awful deep down torrent, oh, and the sea crimson sometimes like fire, and the glorious sunsets and the fig trees and the Alameda Gardens, yes, and all the queer little streets and pink and blue and yellow houses and the rose gardens and the jessamine and geraniums and cactuses and Gibraltar as a girl where I was a flower of the mountain. Yes, when I put the rose in my hair like the Andalusian girls used. Or shall I wear a red? Yes. And how he kissed me under the Moorish wall. And I thought, well, as well him as another. And then I asked him with my eyes to ask again, yes. And then he asked me when I say yes to say yes, my mountain flower. And first I put my arms around him, yes, and drew him down to me so he could feel my breasts all perfume, yes, and his heart was going like mad. And I said, yes, I will, yes, I will, yes. You know, I'm going to read you a little bit of poetry before I finish, and I won't tell you who wrote it, but you see if it sounds like what Molly's just been saying. And all the sun long it was running, it was lovely, the hay fields high as the house, the tombs from the chimneys, it was air and flying, lovely and watery. All the moon long I heard blessed among stables, the night jars flying with the ricks and the horses flashing into the dark. And then to awake in the farm like a wanderer white with the dew come back, the cock on his shoulder, it was all shining, it was Adam and maiden. Do you know what I'm reading? I'm reading a poem called Fern Hill, written by Dylan Thomas. Do you think it sounds as good as Molly's? Fig trees in the Alameda Gardens, yes, and the rose gardens and the jessamine and the geraniums and the cactuses in Gibraltar. It's the same kind of poetry. It's an avalanche of images. Molly, you see, is as good a poet as Dylan Thomas. And that's a point upon which we can end the course.
Dr. David H. Greene is professor of English, New York University. This concludes English C81.1, the literature of modern Ireland. Beginning Monday, January 29th, New York University, in cooperation with WCBS-TV, will offer two courses for college credit. History 27B, a history of modern Russia with Professor Arthur P. Mendel, and Sociology 25, Changing Institutions of Contemporary Africa with Professor Elliot P. Skinner. Applications are now being accepted for college credit or informal participation. For further details, write to Sunrise Semester, Office of Radio Television, New York University, Washington Square, New York 3, New York. Sunrise Semester is presented by the WCBS-TV Public Affairs Department.